Well, good morning all. It is Monday the 25th of June 2018 and it's been a few days thanks to my microphone playing up. I know it's still not perfect, so sorry about the sound. But let's take a look at the news this morning. Daily Mail Online. Women will be allowed to bar transgender people from female-only changing rooms in toilets and swimming pools. Well, thank goodness for that. I mean, seriously. What? People fail to realise is that when the majority behave a certain way and have certain mores and morals, it is those of us who act differently that the onus should be on to fit in, not the other way around. The other way around is called the tyranny of the minority. Ministers say those who identify as female shouldn't get priority over women. And that's a fact. That's true. I mean, it's ludicrous that this whole argument has been made in the first place. It falls apart the moment you realise that a paedophile or a rapist or even just a voyeur could use it to guarantee their ability to mix with women in women's private places. Generally, public bathrooms have what is called a disabled toilet anyway, completely separate. And yes, there might be a little bad reaction on you being forced to use a disabled toilet when you don't consider yourself disabled. But surely that would count as being disabled, wouldn't it? You do have special requirements. As a transgender person, so why not accept that if you feel you really cannot use the men's toilets, that the disabled toilet is there for you? As well as for actual disabled people. Women will continue to have the right to exclude transgender people from female-only changing rooms, laboratories, and swimming sessions. In an apparent change of direction, ministers said the rights of those who identify as women would not be put ahead of those who are biologically female. And this is another thing. I watched an interview, Stephen Crowder interviewing Lacey Green the other day. And she said something that I hadn't really thought of. That the word gender has changed its meaning. It's now very specifically social and not biological at all. Whereas before, it was both. Same as sex in a way. And sex has multiple meanings. Words can have multiple meanings. It's all in context. But when I see gender on a form, I don't think social at all. I think biological. Sex. Plain and simple. And so do a lot of people. And if you want to change the meaning of the word gender to only mean the social, well, you are going to get pushback from people who know the truth, that it doesn't only mean social. Words have changed their meanings over the years. The obvious example is gay. West Side Story, I feel pretty and witty and gay. She wasn't saying she felt homosexual, was she? Not in any way, shape or form. Though I know the social convention is that homosexuals have taken that song to their hearts. Don't know why. Because it wasn't an allegory or a veiled reference. It had nothing to do with homosexuality. Advancing the rights of trans people does not have to compromise women's rights. And the number of trans people is getting larger and larger as the social mores and moles are broken down and science has advanced over the last 50 years to make being transgender easier than it ever was. Maybe someday in the future we'll be able to change people's sex completely. But for now we're not. We're not able to do that. And I personally feel we're moving too fast on the social side when the biological side, the scientific side, hasn't caught up. I can understand the allure of feeling different, being bullied and thinking that you're the wrong sex. But it's such a terminal change. Permanent. And with the hormone replacement required, very dangerous to start in childhood. So I really do dislike how children are pushed into doing this when we all know children change their minds very easily. Quite frankly, the attack on women by trans people is monstrous. Because they are only thinking of themselves. They're thinking selfishly. That their needs come above everyone else's. And specifically women's. And women need to feel safe in a laboratory. And just the ability of a predator to say, I'm identifying as a woman, therefore you've got to allow me in. And come on, we all know it will happen if that becomes a possibility. Because predators love to get into positions where they can sate their vile lusts. They take up jobs as teachers, they become priests, they get positions of authority. They gravitate to those positions where they can feel safe. This shouldn't even be an argument. If you want to have open toilets, like in Ally McBeal, that was a good show. Quite a liberal show in the 90s. Wouldn't be considered that liberal anymore though. Like a lot of things. But if you want to have open toilets like that, and everyone in your office is okay with it, then fine. But you shouldn't force people into it. And that's what transgender people are trying to do to women. Forcing women to accept people who are still biologically male in their safe space. Why would you do that? Anyway, moving on. Birmingham is named as the UK's worst area for food hygiene for the second year running. Birmingham City, or Hindburn in Lancashire, have been named as the UK's worst areas for food hygiene for the second year running after a study by consumer group, Which. Now, I live 20 miles away from Birmingham, from the city centre, and I'm stunned. I don't spend much time in the city anymore. I've never felt the hygiene was particularly bad anywhere near me. And I've got to say to the Brummies, come on. Clean your food shops. You make more money than with a dirty shop. Fox News have been forced to apologise after Trump's former deputy campaign manager says black panelist is out of his cotton picking mind live on air. Now, have you heard of Foghorn Leghorn? a cartoon character, a rooster, or cockerel, who uses that phrase regularly and, well, I grew up seeing that cartoon in England and never even realised what cotton picking was associated with. I had flowers in my 20s. I know in America it's different, and the whole slavery issue is more immediate, even though it's still 150 years ago. But come on. Why are Fox News apologising for someone using a term that is taken from a cartoon? From a non-racist cartoon? From a cartoon that has nothing to do with race whatsoever? A phrase that has permeated through children from this cartoon cockerel, Fogel and Leghorn. I can't do the voice, I'm terrible at impressions. Just hang on a cotton pick a minute. Now, of course, this deputy campaign manager could have been being racist. But if he was, he was obviously trying to hide it. Otherwise he wouldn't have said that term. Because if he was racist, he'd have felt that that term was safe. But who cares if he's racist? He's former deputy campaign manager. And even if he is, you don't know for certain. You can't be certain about that, because at that point, you're looking at thought crime. Because he hasn't actually said anything nasty, he hasn't advocated attacking anybody. I mean, just using the wrong word or term, a word that has permeated through society without that association can now be seen as, well, evil. Fox News are about to apologise for it. I mean, it's ridiculous. It is absolutely ridiculous. If you want to come out with a list of words and terms people are not allowed to say all over the Western world, not just in the US of A, but all over the Western world, then you're going to have to accept that people in different countries have different cultures, and these words don't mean the same thing to them. And yes, I know this was in America, so that point doesn't actually stand for this, but it stands overall. I don't think using the word cotton picking is racist in the slightest. It's not anymore. Or even if it ever was. Yes, black slaves were employed to pick cotton and tobacco and other things too. But I believe the cotton industry didn't go under when slavery went under. I believe they still required people to pick cotton and started having to pay for them. Even if it was indentured servitude, and that's wrong too. But just saying the wrong word, a word that has suddenly been deemed racist. And to someone in England, this is sudden. He really will put his name on anything. Fury as President Trump autographs photos of young victims killed by undocumented immigrants as he tries to push back against child border separation uproar. At a White House event on Friday, Trump brought in 11 people as they each held photographs of their loved ones who have died as a result of the crimes committed by illegal immigrants. Now, obviously, Trump was trying to do a nice thing. And some people have turned it around on him. He wasn't laughing at these people. He wasn't being snide and grinning behind his back and going, yeah, this is great. They're bringing photos of their dead loved ones for me to autograph. No! That wasn't what I was thinking at all. He was trying to be nice and alleviate some of the pain and, you know, last night I was looking through Amazon Prime and I saw a Will Ferrell movie, The Campaign. Now, I don't like Will Ferrell. I find his comedy juvenile and frankly not funny. But I looked at the blurb for The Campaign and thought, a political movie, I'll give it a try. Political comedy, it was very comic. In fact, it was vile and disgusting. It showed Hollywood's deep contempt for the right as a whole, for the people of the Carolinas and the southern US, who it's, Hollywood seems to think are complete morons. And for, well, the American political system in general. And no, this wasn't made last year or this year. It wasn't made after Trump had come to power. It wasn't a attack on Trump in any way, shape or form, because it was made in 2012. During Obama's second election year. And yes, it attacked the Democrats, to be fair, just as much as the Republicans. But on the Democrat side, it was attacking the Democrat candidate, Will Ferrell's character, for his attitude towards politics towards people, and the fact that he was a lying scumbag and a truly vile person. Whereas on the Republican side, well, it attacked Republican values. The strange thing is that I'd have thought they'd have done it the other way around, and Will Ferrell's character would have been a Republican, while Galifianakis' character would have been a Democrat, because, well, I was thinking it was made after Trump had come to power. But no, it was made in 2012. And the things that Will Ferrell gets away with in that movie, yeah, no, America would not accept that at all. Certainly wouldn't vote for him. And yes, at the end, the election was rigged, but they're only winning by 10,000 votes. Not a small number. You know, Hollywood as a whole has a problem. And that problem doesn't lie with big fantasy and science fiction blockbusters or action movies, where the feminists are attacking it and insisting upon female heroines like Rey Skywalker that are just utter Mary Sues. Well, she's not a Skywalker, is she? She's probably going to end up in being one. But the real sexism in Hollywood is in the comedy. It's in the movies that constantly denigrate men. It's in the idea that men and women have to fight. There was another thing I was watching last night, and I'm trying to remember what it was, how it went, but the gist was that, oh, I almost had it then. Another movie from 2012, Ted. Yeah, turn the sexes around. Have Laurie be the one with the teddy. Not Mark Wahlberg's character, or I can't remember his name. Character name. Have Mark Wahlberg be the one telling her she has to grow up, buckle down at work, stop being a child with a teddy. The feminists will be all over it. They realise for what it was. That movie, Ted, is doing what a lot of Hollywood movies do, and that's buttonholing men. Sorry, pigeonholing. Men have to be a certain way, and it's women telling them that they have to be that way. Why is a woman who's been with this man for 4 years, truly loves him, has somehow accepted the teddy bear that actually does talk, is alive, into her life as well. Yes, I know Ted does some truly douchey things, but it doesn't make sense that she'd wait 4 years hoping and hoping that this man would change. And then give him an ultimatum after 4 years. I mean, that would happen after 6 months. Maybe after a year and a half. But 4 years? No. No, sorry, she's not waiting that long. And yes, I know, he gets her back here in the end. Doing the usual schmaltzy Hollywood way. Which in real life doesn't happen. That's a lie to children. When she leaves you, it's very easy to get her back. Hollywood loves that. Especially in the comedies, some of the romantic comedies. Hollywood is built on lies, so when they preach to us that the Republicans are evil, that the right are stupid, bigoted rednecks, well, why should we believe them? Especially when they let the left just get away with whatever. All this about Trump and Stormy Daniels. Sorry, that ship sailed 20 years ago with Bill Clinton. You can't have it one way for Bill and the other way for Donald. No, sorry. In the UK, there was this huge furor in the early mid-90s over David Miller, especially, and other conservative politicians in scandals. Labour took full advantage. Tony Blair called the Conservatives a nasty party. And it worked. But then in the 2000s, there were a bunch of scandals about Labour. And in 2010s, we heard about Keith Vaz, his proclivities. Which I'm not going to go into. But, yeah, he's still a minister. So frankly, to the left, you've done this. You've degraded the mores and morals of Western civilization. You've denigrated marriage. You've pushed single motherhood. You've attacked conservative Republican politicians for doing things that, well, you're quite happy to let your politician get away with. I'm sorry, but adultery doesn't carry the same stigma anymore. But it should do. But it doesn't. A rich man seeing a prostitute. Well, come on. We know it happens. We know that's just one of the perks of being rich. And the left have made their own bed. They made sure the public no longer cares. But enough of the public no longer cares. It's past 50%. The religious, the so-called religious right, many of whom have voted Democrat for years anyway, especially Catholics in America, after John F. Kennedy became the first Catholic president. Yeah, they, Catholics vote en masse for the left. Hispanics vote en masse for the left. Oh, guess what? Hispanics are mainly Catholic. So the so-called religious right, many of whom are voting for the left. So what's left of the American Protestant? Well, not even Protestants, they're not Church of England or Church of America, they're Baptists and born-again Christians and so on. They're a minority. Now, a true minority. Yet Hollywood pushes this lie that they're still a majority. They still have to be fought against. Anyway, let's move on. Want to transform a pupil's life, just ban their phones, says Brighton College headmaster Richard Cairns. He did, and they even thanked him for it. Well, of course they did. Because it's an addiction. I thought, imagine if people were still allowed to smoke in pubs and workplaces and public. Well, there'd be a lot of lot more people smoking. By removing it from pubs and workplaces, you made sure people could only smoke when they weren't doing these things. People who would have been smoking 40 a day suddenly became 10 a day smokers. And it's the same with phones. Yes, they're not as dangerous as cigarettes, but they are still dangerous. The amount of people who get knocked over in the street simply because they're on their mobile phones and aren't looking. Yeah, I'm gonna say it's still too high. You know there's a lot of them. People in cars too on their mobile phones. The kids in school, when They've got their mobile phones with them. They're not concentrating on class, are they? Not concentrating on learning. Yeah, my day was at school was a bit before mobile phones in England. The Americans had cell phones, of course, but mobile phones weren't big over here until a couple of years after I left school. If they had been big over here, it would still have been unthinkable to have them in schools. To allow kids to bring them into school. And I do mean unthinkable. I don't understand how it's become a thing. Because it's plainly stupid. And senseless. And defeats the point of class. You're there to learn, not to text your mates. Or to check TV tropes. Or YouTube. Will Serena Williams be punished for taking maternity leave? John McEnroe blasts Wimbledon snob that may see seven-time champion denied seeding because she took a year off to have a baby. Now, I've actually replied to that thread, so I'll go to my profile for the quick route to the reply. And where is it? Here we go. Remember when Juan Martin Del Potro was on seed at the Olympics and what happened? He was drawn to face Novak Djokovic in the first round, the world number one, and Juan Martin beat Novak in the first round. He ended up beating Rafa Nadal in the semi-final and losing to Andy Murray in the final. Because Juan Martin Del Potro should not have been on seed. It was unfair to him to make him play Djokovic in the first round in the first place, and it was unfair on Novak, who could not have expected a first round opponent that dangerous. A man who by rights would have been one of the big five without those injuries. Yes, it would have been a big five, not a big four. This isn't just unfair to Serena, it's unfair on the other seeds who may be forced to face her in round one, two or three, and face losing points due to how tennis's rankings are calculated just due to buying fortune. Because tennis's rankings are calculated on a year-by-year basis. You do well in a tournament one year, you have to do equally as well the next year in the same tournament, just to maintain your points. Which is ludicrous. It always has been. It always will be. And it penalises those who get injuries. And yes, the tennis authorities do allow for injured players to pause their ranking while they're injured. Which they should have allowed Serena to do as well, because she wasn't injured. She was just on maternity leave. I mean, she didn't have to come back from an injury that could have wrecked her career. No, she just did what millions and millions of women do on a regular basis. She gave birth. And she went back to work afterwards. Quite frankly, I think that Juan Martin Del Potro should not have been unseeded in the Olympics and in the US Open later on that year, which he was also unseeded for. And I think he ended up playing Federer in an early round, but winning. His seeding should have been protected. Her seeding should be protected. I don't care if her world ranking is 576 or 56 or 16. She should still be seeded in the top 8 for all major tournaments, so that to avoid bad draws before the quarterfinals, at least until proven her form isn't now what it was before. And imagine if she was now drawn to face Wozniacki or Muguruza or Halep in the first round at Wimbledon, or the second round at Wimbledon, because she was unseeded. How would those women feel, knowing that their world ranking points were at major risk because they were drawn to face Serena Williams in the first round? And yes, right now you might say that Garbiñe, Caroline, or Simona would easily beat Serena, which I don't believe. It depends on how they play and how she play. Depends on the day. But yeah, they could beat her. Which would also artificially keep her world ranking low, because she wouldn't gain any points that she would have otherwise gained against lower ranked players. It's blatantly unfair either way. And also, what if it's not Garbiñe, Caroline or Simona? What if it's the 18th seed or the 29th seed who may have expected to finally do well at Wimbledon? But oh no, boom, there's Serena Williams, round one. And even though they're seeded, they're going out in the first round. Which may lose their ranking points too, because they got to the second round last year. It's a joke. I don't care for Serena Williams. Personally. I won't do this for anyone. Now, of course, England had an amazing result last night, which I've already talked about in another video. Referee Grisha made a meal of an easy game. Panama players were allowed to get away with wrestling. Graham Pohl, ex-referee. Now, he's right, of course, but only partly. Because Grisha did actually step in the end and stop it. But he still let it go a couple of times beforehand. So he did fail to deal with foul play or blatant dissent from the Panama players. He was guilty of allowing shocking all-in wrestling at virtually every set piece. In the end, he did step in and give England a penalty. Well, actually, we've got two penalties, but the other one was for just a normal foul. Egyptian referee Gerhard Grisha made a real meal of an easy game, in particular allowing shocking all-in wrestling at virtually every set piece. He failed to deal with foul play or blatant dissent, but it was the wrestling which begged belief. Before the corners were taken, he actually delayed the restarts to warn Panama players about misconduct. But once the ball was in play, he ignored blatant holding. They were acting more at home in WWE rather than WCF World Cup Finals. And he's not the only referee to have been doing it. You look at the referee in the Tunisia match. And I understand that VAR is not to blame because VAR are not allowed to stop the game and call it back. If the referee plays on, that's it. VAR can't do anything about it. So it's all the referee's fault. The referees in this World Cup have been relying too much on the safety net of VAR. They're thinking, well, we can use the VAR for these situations when the ball goes out of play and get those right. But it means they've took the eyes off the ball and they're just allowing anything goes with wrestling and blatant cheating. Dives, elbowing somebody else in the face and then holding your own face and riding on the ground. That happened in the England match. Jesse Lingard never even touched this guy. If they had brushed against each other, it would have been to this guy's back in the first place. This guy's going down, holding his own face, because he knows exactly what he's done. And he should be punished retrospectively. But it's not just that incident. It's been happening all over. Pepe for Portugal. It's become a joke. The amount of cheating, blatant cheating that goes on in football. They're not even hiding it anymore. Because they know, one, it works, and two, it doesn't get punished. When the penalty was finally given for holding, it appeared that the 42-year-old ref was told to give it by VAR via his earpiece. Good. That's what VAR should be doing. But they should be watching the entire game, ready to give the referee their opinion any time they see him ignore a blatant foul. Harry Kane and Harry Maguire were both wrestled, but watching Grisha closely, he didn't react as a referee to seeing foul play, move his whistle to his mouth. Instead, he allowed play to continue and only blew after a lengthy display. His display reinforced my belief that World Cup officials should be selected purely on ability and experience and not shared around a variety of FIFA countries. Graham, they have to be shared around because you have to have a neutral referee. If you just took all the referees from Spain, Germany and England, there'd be good chances that in a number of games, referees wouldn't be neutral. So they do have to be shared around, but yes, it should be selected on ability and experience. I'm sorry to Egyptian football, but it's not at the same level. It's nowhere near the same level as even the second tier European nations and the South American nations. What is an MLS referee doing at the World Cup? Against Tunisia, an England win was secured despite weak refereeing. On Sunday, England qualified despite after an inept official performance. And sorry, I'm not going to call that refereeing against Tunisia weak. I'm going to call it blatantly biased. Which is what it was. That referee didn't give England a thing all game. It wasn't weak, it was biased. I expect the less experienced referees to be sent home as England progresses to knockout phases, and just hope it's not a refereeing error which costs England further down the line. With VAR in place, that shouldn't be the case. being their technology is definitely out, being it's far from perfect. Exactly. Because the VAR was called in against Kyle Walker in the Tunisian game. And it should have seen that the Tunisian player deliberately ran into Kyle Walker's back and fell over. Yes, Kyle Walker's arm was out. He was jumping in midair. It was not an elbow. It was not a foul. It definitely was not a penalty. So VAR isn't perfect. We know this. It's also not being used and every time it should be used. It hasn't been used anywhere near enough at all. I think it's coming time for the referee on the pitch to be simply there to maintain order, not to actually make the decisions. We have video technology. That's where the decisions should be made now. Except the obvious ones, obviously. The linesman raises his flag correctly. The referee sees the foul before VAR does. Fine. But VAR needs to be used much more than it is. And to be fair, I think that's it for this morning. Marin Cilic beat Novak Djokovic in longest Queen's final ever. A Serbian sissy won't win Wimbledon. Hey, you've got a good chance, mate. You're one of the top five players in the world now. And you're a very strong grass court opponent. So you've got as good a chance as anyone. Congrats on winning Queens. Alright. Take care all. And hopefully enjoy. Again, I apologise for the bad volume.